Hello and welcome to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest today, Aleema Shivji, the Chief Executive of Handicap International UK. Aleema, thank you very much for joining us and welcome to the programme.
Thank you. I've
invited you on partly because I don't know how many international charity chief executives we have harboured here in Brighton, but between our studio and the station, there you are billeted away. So not too far to come today. Just over a year ago, you were somewhere very different, and it's a year since the earthquake in Nepal.
That's right.
Were you there for that earthquake?
I was there just a few weeks before, actually, visiting one of our programs that was put to the test during the earthquake. So we've been working with the governments in Nepal and our local partners for many years, preparing for just an earthquake like the one that happened last year to come. Nepal is one of the most at-risk countries in the world for earthquakes, but knowing that means that you can prepare for it. So we've been working for many years, training health workers and working with hospitals to prepare for mass influx of injuries. So when I was there just a few weeks before the earthquake, it was to visit that program. I met with the Nepali doctors in the hospitals that we worked with, where they talked to us about, told me about the work that my team had been doing with them to prepare for an earthquake like the one that happened on the 25th of April.
At the risk of sounding sort of glib or facetious, your timing was impeccable. I mean, you left, what, about a week before it struck?
It was just a couple of weeks before it struck, and I had a bit of a moment of thinking, it was nice to have gone just before and see the preparedness. At the same time, my background as a physiotherapist and as a disaster management professional, had I been there at the time as well, I would have gone into a different mode, I think, and really supported our country team. Not that they needed my support. I mean, within hours, they were on the ground in the hospitals providing urgent rehabilitation to people with injuries.
And what sort of, I mean, first of all, when the earthquake happens, what sort of injuries are you, Handicap International, I guess the sort of name gives us a clue. What sort of people are you looking after?
Well, generally in an earthquake, you get sort of three types of main injuries. You get a lot of fractures, broken bones, you get a lot of amputations, and you get a lot of spinal injuries. All three of those, without rehabilitation, can lead to permanent disabilities, but also, for example, in the case of spinal injury, can lead to death. So the work that we do is really essential to minimize that long-term disability and really give people who've been affected by an earthquake a chance to go back to school, go back to work and live their lives again.
So I mean, part of it is about sort of like medical care, and part of it's about the recuperation and the rehabilitation and sort of getting life back to normal.
Absolutely.
I mean, how many people does a sort of an organization like yours actually have on the ground in somewhere like Nepal?
So our team before the earthquake was probably around 50, mostly Nepali, so we only had two foreign staff in the country. For us, it's really important to work with local staff who help themselves, but we had a whole network of partners as well, local partners around the country, so that can go into the hundreds. We did grow the team after the earthquake because the needs were massive. As people probably remember from the footage, the earthquake hit just outside of Kathmandu, the capital, but in some really hilly remote areas, so getting to those areas requires a lot of resources. So we did really grow our team size for a period of time to be able to reach those remote areas.
And I mean, when you were there, were you based in Kathmandu, or did you visit some of the more sort of, when people say it's remote, Brighton University has sort of helped set up a school in Nepal a few years ago, and they went out to visit, and we spoke to them after they'd sort of one of their trips, and they were just saying, what looks like a little distance on a map and is probably 20 miles is an epic journey. I said, a bit like going from sort of Hangleton to Saltdean in Brighton and Hove, and I think they were sort of, yes, I was probably being a little too facetious there, but
It's absolutely, I mean, the distances, yes, you're right, on a map, the distances are really short, but because it's very hilly and there are not roads everywhere, you often have to go quite a long distance through a valley to get, literally just go around a mountain. So people have to walk for miles and miles, and what was happening after the earthquake, and is still the case today, is if somebody wants to get access to health services or go to school or access rehabilitation, it can be miles and miles of walking up and down steep hills. And that was the same case for us. In order to be able to deliver aid, there weren't roads everywhere. So in some cases, we were taking aid by foot or on the back of an animal, and in extreme cases by helicopter, really to get to people that were completely cut off.
When you went there to check sort of preparedness, were you just based in Kathmandu, or did you sort of get out into the
So I did get to see some of the remote areas, although not the areas that were affected by the earthquake. I was actually visiting, interestingly, one of our other preparedness programs, which is in the west part of the country, which was preparing for floods, which is something that happens every year. And there had just been some massive floods, and so I'd actually visited after the floods had happened. And it was really fascinating to see the impact of what we had done to prepare a community so that they knew if they knew how to read the weather, they knew how to read the river levels, and if they started to rise, people would start evacuating to centres that we had helped build with local partners on higher ground so that they could, you know, make sure that they can protect themselves and their livestock as well in the case of a disaster. So I did see some of the remote areas, and it gives you a sense of what that area affected by
and the scale of the challenges, presumably, when something... Because if that's getting around in normal circumstances, I imagine after an earthquake where what roads there are can become impassable, I guess.
Absolutely. So a lot of the roads were completely damaged and destroyed, which meant that people just could not get to aid, could not get to services. So we were treating injured people that sometimes had been, you know, carried for days before they could even get to health services, which, you know, increases the chance of complications, makes the surgeries much more complicated, and then requires much more rehabilitation afterwards.
And what sort of... you were talking about the preparedness for the sort of health services. What sort of things do the people working in the health services there, the doctors, the nurses, need to learn before?
So one of the main things we were actually doing was training health workers, surgeons, for example, on injury surgical protocols. So with an amputation, if the amputation is done well, there's more of a chance of that child or that adult actually being able to be fit with an artificial or a prosthetic limb. And so we had been for many years training the health workers on how to do the surgeries in the best way possible to get the best.
As a clean amputation,
yes.
It sounds on one level, it sounds on one level quite sort of bizarre, but very necessary, a very necessary precondition for a good recovery.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I mean, I don't know. Again, it was literally just over a year ago. I mean, one remembers the news reports that there's a big disaster. I mean, can you put it into any kind of context? What's the scale of what happened in Nepal?
Sure. So first of all, the earthquake happened, there was two earthquakes, so we really only usually hear about the first one. It was 7.8 on the Richter scale, which is quite high. There was about 8,000 people that were killed in that earthquake and around 22,000 injured, so quite a significant number. It was then followed by a second earthquake, and to this day there are still aftershocks. So you have not only the physical impact, the deaths and the injuries, but then you also have the psychological impact for, you know, hundreds of thousands of people that are still living today in fear. Some people still scared to live inside their homes again because they're worried the walls will fall down. So the scale of the disaster is huge. I'm really proud to say that our organization has supported more than 6,000 people with injuries. So, you know, you're looking at, you know, more than a quarter of the people affected by the earthquake, in general terms, where we've been able to provide essential rehabilitation and psychosocial support to those individuals.
And so this, how would that be in practical terms? Is that sort of just helping with exercises to get back on their feet, as it were, or
absolutely,
or to use upper arms?
Yep. So it can be, so for example, somebody with a spinal injury, we might be training them of how to, you know, if they're paralyzed, we might be training them and their family members of how to, for example, roll over, get in and out of bed, do basic things like how to go to the loo again. It's really simple stuff that you and I take for granted, but after a spinal injury is quite massive. After an amputation, we would be teaching somebody exercises initially to get them up and out of bed and get them home. And then once they're, you know, their injury is a bit more stable, then get them fitted with an artificial leg. And I think one of the key things there is that, you know, with injuries like that, it's not a one-off thing. You know, a growing child, like a 7 or 8 year old, is going to need another leg every 6 months as she or he grows, which is a huge endeavor, and a lot of support that they will need for the rest of their lives.
So you're not just in there for the sort of the quick hit, if you like, after an earthquake struck, something like that, but in for the long haul.
Absolutely. So we're already in the country for a long time, and we anticipate we will still be there for a while. We work with local partners, and one of the great things there is that we've got some really, really motivated partners. And so our role changes over time because it's really supporting them to be able to support their fellow Nepalis.
And also, I mean, because you were saying before, and perhaps we could touch this after the break, but you've worked as a physiotherapist, you've worked in sort of disaster management. What's your role sitting here back in Britain now while all this sort of unfolds and the aftermath, etc.? What do you do?
I think my main role today is really to raise awareness about the work that we do so that we can get the support we need in order to be able to deliver the services that we have been delivering in Nepal and other countries, and to be ready for that next earthquake.
And is it just in Nepal that you work, or is Handicap International? I mean, the name kind of suggests to me that it's not just in Nepal, but I don't know if you could let me know the sort of bit of the scale of
sure.
Your
so
reach.
We work in around 60 countries around the world, so it is quite a large reach, and we work in context for everything from disasters like earthquakes, but also conflicts. So, for example, in the Syrian crisis, right through to countries that need long-term support to help poverty alleviation.
Well, before we take a break, just perhaps you could tell me why the focus on Nepal at the moment.
It's 1 year on from the earthquake, and often what happens is the disaster, when it strikes, it's in the news, everybody thinks about it, and then you forget about it and think, well, the disaster's over.
Yeah.
But as I've said just earlier, a child with an amputation is going to need support for their whole life. So it's not a one-off support, a couple of months after an earthquake. It is a long-term, long-term support that people will need. So I think it's important to put the spotlight back on countries like Nepal. So that we don't forget that there are longer term needs there.
So it's quite good in a way to sort of say, not just that we did this at the time, but actually we're still doing these things now.
Absolutely.
Well, listen, we're going to take a short break. I'd love to come back and sort of talk to you about what you're doing to raise money for what's happening there, because you're putting your own effort into this as well, I gather. So we're just going to take a short break for these ads. Please, this is how we make our money, so please don't go away. And please join us again after the break. Hello, welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest, Aleema Shivji, from Handicap International UK. I hope I've said that right. With a surname like LeDuc, I'm used to hearing mine mangled. So, we were talking before the break about the work going on in Nepal at the moment, and you seem to have a sort of a set window for some fundraising, which the like of which I don't think I've come across. I don't know if you could explain to me, the government's being very kind and generous, words that don't normally pass through my lips. What's that all about?
Absolutely. So we, on the 18th of April, we launched a new campaign called Every Step Counts, and it's a campaign that's raising essential funds for to help disabled and injured children and adults walk again by providing sustainable rehabilitation. The exciting thing about this campaign is until the 18th of July, every donation we receive, every pound we raise, is doubled by the UK government. So it's a fantastic opportunity for our supporters to know that the donations they're making, the support they're giving us, is going to have twice the impact. It's going to help twice the disabled people around the world, help twice the number of injured children walk again.
So it's not just a Nepal, although Nepal is obviously uppermost in many people's minds at the moment, one year on. It's not just about raising money for Nepal, but for your work globally. And
absolutely.
Does the government do this a lot? Is this sort of, have you managed to twist George Osborne's arm or the International Development Secretary, Justin Greening's arm? Or is this something they do quite a lot, but perhaps we just don't realise?
It is one of the programmes that they, one of the flagship programmes that the International Development Department does run for the UK government. And they do select a small number of charities every year. We go through a process, we apply. And once you've gone through that process, then you if you're successful, as we have been, then you have a window to be able to have your donations matched. So it's called the UK Aid Match.
Oh, okay. Campaign. So you've got this 3 month burst of campaigning now to raise as much money as you can.
Absolutely.
To take advantage of. Is there a cap on their generosity or?
There is. I don't have the number in my head, but it is quite a significant.
It's a challenging
cap. It's a challenging cap.
Okay, yeah. So or generous one. We could yes. Say. Well, let's be kind to the politicians for once and say, you're charitable. You can be. And does gift aid still work as well?
It does. So gift aid does work. Gift aid isn't matched. But gift aid itself, we will get gift aid on the donations that we receive from people who are gift aid.
So presumably you're trying to get people to give you sort of one-off donations, but also to actually sign up and give you a sort of standing order or a direct debit or something.
Absolutely.
Like that. Are you going to be doing any fundraising yourself?
I am. So I've had my little rubber arm twisted to do a challenge myself. We're really encouraging our supporters to, obviously donations are great, but it's also an opportunity for people to take part in challenges themselves. So we've got loads of people that are thinking about doing marathons and running and swimming and... So I have decided that I'm going to do the South Downs Way in 5 days, followed by
lovely.
A four-day canoe across the northern part of Scotland.
Wow.
So obviously the South Downs Way for me is it's home, it's local. I've done bits and pieces of it. I'm really excited to be able to do it as a challenge, hopefully have a few friends join for part of the way, and be able to get support from friends and family in the area.
It's beautiful scenery. I mean, we're a very remote place. Transport across Sussex is terribly slow. Probably going by foot's a good move. And how many how many days are you going to take to do
it? Because so we're doing it in five, so it's 102 miles in 5 days. We are a little bit crazy, but we're looking forward to it. Well, and if the weather goes well, we're going to try to kayak the last part. Okay. Well, Seven Sisters.
Wow. Well, you're doing it in the summer, so it is our rainy season. So
it is. Good but, waterproofs,
I Yeah, would well, say. It'd be good training for going to the Great Glen, because I'm sure even in the height of summer, it probably rains in Scotland.
That's what I'm anticipating.
Yeah. Take your waterproofs. And I mean, if it's not a silly question, how do, because you don't sound like you've got the strongest of Brighton or Sussex accents, how does someone like you end up as running sort of Handicap International's UK sort of arm, if you like, and being down in Brighton?
Sure. So, I mean, I initially trained as a physiotherapist, but okay. I knew I always wanted to work in international development, and I came across Handicap International about 11 years ago, actually, and started working with them, where I was actually using my physio skills to train health workers, for example, in Sri Lanka, work with surgeons in South Sudan on surgery protocols. And a few years ago, I took a break and I came to Sussex to do a master's. And I've been here ever since. Took over the chief executive role in 2012.
It's really unusual.
Brighton's home.
I was going to say, it's really unusual hearing someone say, I came to Sussex as a student and decided to stay. No, I'm being very sarcastic. It's one of the lovely things about here, I guess, and we attract talent from around the world. Where's home originally?
Home is in Edmonton, Canada, the western part of Canada.
Okay, so a bit warmer here.
A bit warmer here, a bit more rainy, but definitely a bit warmer.
Okay, and in terms of how you sort of progressed through Handicap International, so did you started working for them as a physiotherapist, did you?
I did, yeah.
And you ended up running the shop?
Over the course of the years I've been there, just lots of different roles. I spent quite a number of years running our emergency response program. So for example, I was running the health program and then running the country program in Haiti after the big earthquake in 2010. I was running our response to floods in Pakistan. I've worked in a number of different countries. And so I still use to this day my physio skills, but in a more indirect way. So when I'm trying to, for example, lobby the government to strengthen their policies for disabled people in developing countries, I draw on my experience quite regularly.
I mean, we parents of disabled children in this country will say it's no walk in the park. I mean, there are a lot of challenges just to get the basic sort of level of support that you need. Mm-hmm. And I presume that's a picture that's reflected in the countries you work in.
Absolutely. Or
worse? I mean, I don't know
I would say in many ways worse. I mean, I think there's still, it's no denying it, there's still lots more that can be done in the UK as well. But, if I take an example of a 14-year-old boy, Sandesh, that we helped. So he lost both his legs when he was at school during the earthquake. A wall fell on him. He lost his legs. He also lost his best friend. And it took 8 months before the school could agree for him to go back to school. All he'd done is lost his legs. Wow. But the school was not set up. They were scared, they didn't know how to manage a child with a physical injury, let alone any other type of disability. So just to give you a sense of the challenges that, kids
sort
face.
What sort of things can Handicap International do in a situation like that? What do you do to help?
So in some cases, we might do really basic things like make the school accessible. But in other contexts, for example, in the Congo, we're doing a lot of work with the government to develop policy on it, to help them strengthen their policy on education for disabled children to be within that framework. So it might mean training teachers. We also do awareness sessions with parents so that parents of the non-disabled children are accepting that a disabled child goes to school with them, which is something we don't really have to think about in this country.
Well, no, and presumably, I mean, I think when we were talking before the programme, you were saying just working with the school, for example, some really basic things like, if a school's on more than one level, for example, more than one floor, some of the issues that come alive then, where the toilets are, for example, etc. So for people who've lost lower limbs, I mean, I take it this is really sort of basic stuff on one level, but is it the case of sort of after a disaster that actually some of these issues become brought into a lot more sort of focus, a lot more widely?
Absolutely. It's often the case, I think it's horrible to say, but often it is the disaster that helps to bring awareness into a country. And it's a disaster which really kind of unlocks support for a country, which then allows us not only to respond to the disaster, but build long-term sustainable programs on the back of that.
In terms of building this, do you have sort of staff from somewhere like, I mean, have you got many staff in this country or?
Really small team in this country. We've got 18 staff in this country. So for example, one of my team members here is a physiotherapist and he works with the government and the National Health Services to train therapists from the National Health to be able to deploy in disasters.
So I know we've got sort of members of our local fire service here who, when there are, you know, like after the Haiti earthquake, for example, went out and helped with the rescue efforts. You likewise, you're working with the health service, the NHS, to do the same sort of thing. Yep. And does that, presumably that works across all the different disciplines and all the different sort of parts of the sort of emergency services here? It's one of these things we're probably just a little less aware of than the more things we see more immediately. But in terms of what happens next with if people want to get involved or take part, I mean, we've all heard of Oxfam, we've all heard of Save the Children, etc. This is, in terms of, obviously, your part of your role is raising the profile of Handicap International. How do people find out more?
So probably the easiest way is to go to our appeal webpage. So the campaign is called Every Step Counts, and we've got a dedicated website set up called, it's www.everystepcounts.org.uk. Okay. They can get much more information about the campaign, they can donate, they can also do a challenge. We're in a great place to do some walking, biking, running, cycling, hiking. There's loads of options in Brighton, even a bake sale at work. Loads of different ways that people can get involved.
Yeah, no, I like supporting bake sales.
And
also, I mean, the everystepcounts.org.uk website, that's got information too about some of the people you've helped, case studies, if you like, to for people to get a sort of, if you like, visualise what actually happens with their money as well. I mean, in terms of, have you been back to Nepal since the earthquake? Or will you be going back?
I haven't gone back since. I've had a team member that was actually in there. He was running the one of our rehabilitation programs in the spinal hospital. In country, we still have a large team, primarily Nepali, that will continue to work alongside our local partners.
But if it's not a silly question, how do you judge whether your efforts, your work on the ground has been a success, has paid off?
I think in a very basic way, when you talk to a small child and who says, I can now go back to school, or a parent who says, I can now go back to work because the services are in place for my child, that's a very basic way of showing the real impact. I think in a more macro way, we know that 80% of the money we raise goes towards the programs we support. So on a more global way, we know that we're doing really, providing really, really effective services.
Well, thank you very much for telling us all about that. Good luck. The website again was www.everystepcounts.org.uk.
That's right.
So good luck with your South Downs Challenge and the Great Glen. I hope you don't get too wet. Maybe on the water, that's a big wish. And good luck with all the work in Nepal in particular as well. So Aleema, thanks very much for joining us. Please watch again soon. And we'll be talking about more of the issues of the day on the vote very soon. That's goodbye from me for now.